I see a lot of potential right now in the liquid because, to be honest, when we started integrating liquid, the handful of companies were using liquid. And it developed, right, with the BMN, with the Infinite Fleet, and we also supported a few other companies to issue. So we see there is a growth. On the other side, I see also when, you know, sovereign bonds like El Salvador's bond will be on liquid, that will open a complete new door, which is huge. STOs, in simple sense, means issuance of digital securities. These are regulated securities by nature. It just happened to be in digital format. On the other side, you have the ICOs, IEOs, right? Initial coin offering or initial exchange offering, whatever you call it. These are kind of a non-securities offering. So what these are, right? These are tokens, which can be also your apple or your banana. It can get rotten. It can be thrown. The only rights you have is as a consumer, right? There is no more right. There is no investor protection. There is no, you know, market regulator looking after those assets. There is nothing. And it's very interesting when I'm also mentioning the STOs and IPOs, how these things are different, right? There is an IPO, initial public offering, where you issue shares, bonds, and stocks to retail as well as professional investors. How it differentiates from the STO. Crucial difference, I would say here, is the form in which these financial instruments are issued. When you buy a shares of stocks or bonds, these are primarily held with a custodian in some digital or paper format. And when an investor holds that, they do not hold that shares or bond in their own account. They hold via custodian or via some third parties, right? So you have a claim towards that third party. Whereas in an STO, when you hold a digital securities or a security token, let's say in this case, we have this phenomenal instrument called Blockstream mining node. When you hold the BMN in your green wallet, you have the full right. It gives you pure ownership. You don't require to hold it via custodian. You don't require to hold it via any middleman. And that creates a complete new dynamics in the market, which you have not seen before. I think the primary benefit which I see from tokenization perspective. Okay, so there are two sides over here. One side, you have the investors. One side is you have the issuers who are issuing. I think for them, the low cost is very important. When you go to a traditional IPO, you usually spend around something 500,000 to 1 million to do a decent issuance with so many middlemen, so many structures. And then there is a continuous reporting obligation, which are most of the time are very manual. With security token, we did some analysis internally. You can reduce the cost by 40% of what your existing cost is because your entire compliance can be automatized because security token can only be transferred between identified individual. The second is a lot of these digital asset exchange will look into the securities place and securities trading venue place, right? And they're all, I think, somewhere thinking of acquiring some kind of licenses that will enable them because these guys are technologically very well advanced as compared to current traditional stock markets, right? So and they also have the user basis, right? They have millions of customers who have already KYC'd, who are quite sophisticated to understand the private key, public key concept. And these guys will attract more of this kind of traditional investors also. So it will be a kind of win-win for them to have both kind of activities, both secondary trading for securities, as well as secondary trading for normal cryptocurrencies, right? And this is also, I would say, one more important aspect in driving the push.